بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا ومولانا محمد حبيب رب العالمين وعلى آله الطيبين الطاهرين وأصحابه الغر الميامين ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد الفاتح لما أغلق والخاتم لما سبق ناصر الحق بالحق والهادي إلى صراطك المستقيم وعلى آله وصحبه حق قدره ومقداره العظيم سبحانك لا علم لنا إلا ما علمتنا إنك أنت العليم الحكيم فاللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا وانفعنا بما علمتنا ووفقنا للعمل فيما يرضيك عنا بجاه النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم وبسر الفاتحة بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم Praise be to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Lord of the heavens and the earth, and we ask Him to send His peace and blessings upon our Master Sayyiduna Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, upon His blessed family, His loyal companions, and all of those who followed after with excellence up until the day of standing. Ameen, ameen, ameen. Thereafter, Allah Azza wa Jal, through His blessings, has gathered us once again in a house from amongst His houses to remember His beloved sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. So there can't be anybody who is more fortunate than us, except those who are sitting in similar gatherings to these, for these gatherings are an imitation of that gathering which he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would conduct with his companions radiyallahu anhum ajma'een. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He connects this gathering onto that gathering, and that He blesses this gathering as He blessed that gathering, and that He benefits through this gathering as He benefited through those gatherings sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa barak wa sallam. Thereafter, we will be studying through this blessed book by this blessed Imam, the Imam of the Ahlus Sunnati wal Jama'ah in our times, one of the greatest scholars of Hadith, who resided in Makkah al-Mukarramah. There is a short biography of the Shaykh right at the beginning of the book. I encourage everybody to have this book. And being connected to these texts is very important. Being connected to these texts is very important. And being familiarizing ourselves with these texts and the authors of these texts is also very important. Is that clear? And we all need to have libraries in our houses where we have books that speak about the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, where we have books that speak about our religion, speak about the Quran al-Kareem. Is that clear? We have to be attached. This is something very important. So I encourage everybody to have a book. Right at the beginning of the book, there's a short biography of this great Imam. His name was, he was a Sayyid from both his mother's side and his father's side. And his father named him Muhammad. His name was Muhammad and his father's name was Alawi. And his grandfather's name was Abbas. And his great-grandfather's name was Abdul Aziz. And both through his mother and his father, his lineage and his family tree went right the way back to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wa alihi wasallam. He was born in Makkah al-Mukarramah, and he studied his initial studies with his father at home. And this is something very important that I want to highlight here in the biography of the Shaykh. That if we, when we read the biographies of the great scholars of Islam, this is something which we will always find, that their studies started at home. Their initial Quran studies, their initial studies of their religion started with their parents in their homes. And then after, they would move on to madrasas and move on to schools and institutes and faculties where they would further their studies. But the seeds of these beautiful flowers were all planted by their parents at home. And this is something very important, that we need to plant beautiful flowers in our homes that blossom one day with the color and the beauty of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Is that clear? And the Shaykh, he traveled extensively across the earth. He traveled extensively across the earth, and wherever he went, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala granted him qabool, granted him acceptance in the hearts of people because of who he was, because of where he came from, and because of the benefit that he gave this ummah. He wrote over 100 works, of them, 80 of them are in print. He wrote 100 works of them, 80 of them are in print, and so many of them have been translated into so many languages of the world. Is that clear? And he resided in Makkah al-Mukarramah. He studied in Al-Azhar al-Sharif in Egypt, and he was granted license to teach, ijazat, to teach from scholars from across the earth, right? Who were his teachers, and they allowed him to. In Makkah al-Mukarramah, it is said that there is a Kaaba. We all know of the Kaaba, isn't it, in Makkah al-Mukarramah? They say that that's the Kaaba of worship in Makkah. But there was a Kaaba of knowledge in Makkah too, towards which students of knowledge and scholars were pulled and attracted towards, and that was the house of Sayyid Muhammad rahmatullahi alayhi. It was the Kaaba of knowledge in Makkah al-Mukarramah, and he was honored that he taught in Masjid al-Haram, like his father and his grandfather. They all taught in Masjid al-Haram, and they taught in Madinatul Munawwara also. So this person is a very blessed person who wrote the biography of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and we narrate this book from the Sayyid, from the Shaykh directly, without anybody in between. We narrate from him this work with a unbroken chain of narration, where he allowed us and licensed us to teach his book and to narrate his book from him directly. Is that clear? That's a short biography of the Shaykh. And then on page one, we have the author's introduction, where he begins by praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and sending peace and blessings upon the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And then he says that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was the one by whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala opened people's eyes after blindness. At the time when the Prophet ﷺ came to this world, people were in a state of blindness, even though they had sight, even though they had eyes. But what does Allah say in the Quran? Allah says, they have eyes, but they don't see. They have ears, but they don't hear. They have hearts, but they don't comprehend. Is that clear? So those blind eyes and deaf ears and hearts that did not comprehend, when the Prophet ﷺ came, reality became clear to those eyes, so hence they were given vision. Reality became clear to those ears, so hence they were able to hear. Reality became clear to those hearts, so hence they were able to comprehend. Sometimes realities are clouded and things become unclear. This is why the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he used to make a dua, and he used to say, Allahumma arina al-haqqa haqqan warzuqna ittiba'ah. Oh Allah, show us the truth as it is the truth and allow us to follow it. Wa arina al-batila batilan warzuqna ijtinabah, and allow us to see falsehood as it is falsehood and allow us to keep away from it. Why? Because, and we have our times is an example for that. For what? For falsehood seeming to be the truth. Our time is probably the best example of when falsehood seems to be absolutely true. Is that clear? When minds become clouded and minds become unclear and confused, and people say, well, everybody's doing this and it seems to be the way. But in reality, the reality of things has been covered. So hence, people see that which is true to be false, and that which is false to be true. Is that clear? And that's a sign of the Dajjalic times. That's a sign of the end of times. For those, there will be people who will see the Dajjal and they will say, he's God. Wal-iyazu billah. And others will say, no, he's not God. But those who will say he is God, what will happen to their minds? That they will see falsehood to be the truth, and they will see the truth to be false. Is that clear? And this is something very important in our times. This is something very important in the times that we live in. For when people are called towards the religion, sometimes they reply in a way as if it's false. Sometimes they reply in a way that what they are being called towards is false, right? So they are making in their minds reality as falsehood and falsehood as reality. But the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he came and he cleared the sky and he cleared the horizon and he moved away the clouds of unclarity, so people were able to see with clear vision. Is that clear? Naam. And then the Shaykh, he says, the prophetic sciences and the Muhammadan qualities are among the greatest matters that one should be fully apprised of and to which one should devote one's attention. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is that being whom we should give attention to. We should not only give attention, but that should be the center point of our attention. The center point of our mind should be the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He said the scholars have therefore authored many works on this. Some scholars authored lengthy works, encyclopedias on the life of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Like Imam Shami, he wrote a book called Subulul Huda wal Rashad fi Sirati Khair al Ibad, and this is in maybe about 15 enormous volumes, really big volumes, right? It's an encyclopedia just on the life of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And there were others who wrote short poems, there were others who wrote short books on the life of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The author here, Sayyid Muhammad rahmatullah alayhi, said, when I saw that people's enthusiasm for reading such books was lost, then I hastened to gather a comprehensive abridgment of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam's life, comprising of two parts. The first part that the Shaykh writes here in this book speaks about the blessed lineage of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, speaks about his relatives, his uncles, his aunts, both from his mother and father's side, the freed slaves that he had, his servants, his bodyguards, the scribes who used to write for him, the letters that he wrote, the envoys and the delegations that he sent to kings and governors of the world, and so on. This is the first portion of the book. And the second portion of the book is a chronological timeline of the blessed life of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, right from his blessed birth until his departure from this world and return unto Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So inshallah, today we will begin with the first part. We'll begin with the first part of this book, which is a summary of the Prophet's sallallahu alaihi wasallam states and matters unique to his noble person sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Is that clear? The Shaykh rahmatullah alayhi, he starts with chapter 1 and he says lineage and early life. Lineage and early life. Now, what's lineage? A person's family tree. Why is this important? Why is this important? People boast, if they come from a prestigious, honorable family, people boast about this, right? And people are proud about this, and people feel honored that they hail from such and such a family, such and such a people. Is that clear? It brings honor and dignity to a person when they speak about their parents, when they speak about their grandparents. And this is natural in all human beings, that people have a natural instinct within themselves to want to speak about their parents, want their parents to be praised before them, and this will bring happiness and joy to their hearts. Is that clear? If somebody comes and praises our parents and speaks about the qualities of our parents, we become happy, we become joyful. Why? Because we have a connection onto them. Is that clear? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he spoke about his blessed lineage, but he didn't just speak about his blessed lineage because he felt honored and he felt dignified through that blessed lineage that Allah azza wa jal granted him. but also so that we can all learn lessons from his blessed lineage. Why? Because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Ana khiyarun min khiyarin min khiyar." He said, "Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose me from the best of the best of the best." And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that all of my forefathers, from my immediate parents, Sayyiduna Abdullah and Sayyida Amina radiyallahu anhuma, right the way back to Adam alayhi salam, they were all from nikah. Each and every one of them, their marriages, their relationships, their bonds were connected with nikah, with a legal and a legitimate relationship. وَلَمْ يَكُنْ فِيهِمْ سِفَاحٍ. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, amongst none of my forefathers, right the way back to Adam alaihi salam, was there any adultery, any fornication, or any relationship that was out of wedlock. And this is something very important that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is teaching us, that we keep our lineages pure, we keep our relationships pure, we keep our bonds pure and clean. Why? Because the purity of relationships and the purity of bonds, the purity of males and females being connected, has a great impact upon their children. Is that clear? Has a great impact upon their children. Is that clear? So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam spoke about his forefathers for this reason, to indicate to us that the goodness that we see in the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, one of the reasons for this is that Allah azza wa jal kept his lineage right the way back to Adam alaihi salam totally pure and clean and clear. Is that clear? The Shaykh, he said, his noble lineage. Now this is something very, very important, that each and every one of us knows by memory the lineage of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. If somebody was to ask us our names and the names of our fathers and the name of our grandfathers, we would be honored to tell them, right? But to know about the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam should be an even more important matter to each and every one of us. We should all know the lineage of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who his father was, who his grandfather was, who is his great grandfather, right the way back to Adnan. Who was Adnan? Adnan was one of the great 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 grandfathers of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned his lineage up to Adnan, and then he said, after Adnan, the historians made mistakes. The Prophet knew, but the historians made mistakes, so that's why he stopped there. Why did he stop there? So that people don't later on accuse him and say, but the historians say like this and you're saying like this. Is that clear? He stopped there and he said, after this, his lineage continues on to the Prophet, Sayyiduna Ismail alayhi salam, to Sayyiduna Ibrahim alayhi salam, and from him, right the way back to Sayyiduna Adam alayhi salam. He said, he is Sayyiduna Muhammadun sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the son of Abdullah. Abdullah was his direct father. The son of Abdul Muttalib, the son of Hashim. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came from the family of Hashim. Is that clear? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Allah azza wa jal chose Quraysh. And from Quraysh, he chose Banu Hashim. And from Banu Hashim, he chose me. Allah chose Quraysh, and from Quraysh he chose Banu Hashim, and from Banu Hashim Allah chose me. And Hashim was the son of Abdi Manaf, who was the son of Qusay, who was the son of Kilab, who was the son of Murrah, who was the son of Ka'b, who was the son of Lu'ay, who was the son of Ghalib, who was the son of Fihr, who was the son of Malik, who was the son of An-Nadr, who was the son of Kinana, who was the son of Khuzaymah, who was the son of Mudrika, who is the son of Ilyas, who is the son of Mudar, who is the son of Nizar, who is the son of Ma'd, who is the son of Adnan, until Ismail, the Prophet Ismail alayhi salam, the son of of Allah's friend, Sayyiduna Ibrahim alayhi salam. This is the lineage of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam that me and you and everybody should know. We should know this by memory. Is that clear? Why? because it's of importance. How do we know if it's of importance? If it wasn't of importance, the Prophet wouldn't have taught us. He wouldn't have told us what his lineage was. Is that clear? But the Prophet ﷺ was teaching us through his blessed family, and mankind only lives through examples. Human beings only live through examples. Is that clear? And you see that clear in our times and in every times. Right, you'll see people with a certain fashion of hairstyle, you'll see people wearing a particular type of clothes, driving a particular type of car. You ask them why? You say, because so-and-so's got a hairstyle like this, right? So-and-so wears these clothes, right? So-and-so's got a car like this. We only mirror each other. Allah Azza wa Jal wants us to mirror the best of creation, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allah Azza wa Jal wants us to emulate the best of His creation, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and the greatest of men that He ever created, and the most beautiful and the best of families that ever tread upon this earth. Then the Shaykh rahimahullah said, His blessed bath, he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was born on Monday, during the month of Rabi'ul Awwal, in the year of the elephant. Right? No, none of the scholars have a dispute that he was born in the month of Rabi'ul Awwal. But the scholars said, why was he not born in Ramadan? Ramadan is a blessed month, isn't it? Why was he not born in the sacred months? What are the four sacred months? Zulqa'dah, Zulhijjah, Muharram, and Rajab. They were sacred even with the people of Jahiliyyah. Even before Islam, these were sacred months in which the Arabs wouldn't wage war against each other. Why wasn't he born in any one of these months? The scholars said, the reason why he wasn't born in any of those blessed months that were mentioned was so that people don't later on say he is blessed because he was born in a blessed month. Rather, Allah Azza wa Jal sent him in a neutral month that people didn't think to be blessed as such, so that this month of Rabi'ul Awwal can take from his blessing, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Likewise, the scholars said, why wasn't he born, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, on a Friday? Why was he born on Monday? Because if he was born on a Friday, then people would have said, he is blessed because he was born on Friday. Allah gave him a neutral day, which is Monday, so that Monday becomes blessed through him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Is that clear? And he was born in the year of the elephant. What happened in the year of the elephant? We all know the story of the king, Abraha, who sent an army towards Makkah al-Mukarrama, right, to destroy the Ka'bah al-Musharrafa. And he sent an army of elephants, right? And elephants are gigantic, aren't they? And this army was marching towards Makkah al-Mukarrama. And as it reached the outskirts of Makkah, the grandfather of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Abdul Muttalib, was there, right? And he went up to one of the people in that army and he said, you owe me some camels, right? Pay up. And the man said, we've bought an army of elephants to destroy your Kaaba, to destroy your sacred house that you deem to be sacred. We've come to destroy that, and you're asking about your camels? And Abdul Muttalib said to him, those camels belong to me and I want them back. Inna lil bayti rabban yahmihi. As for the house, as for that sacred Kaaba, it has a Lord who will protect it himself. Don't worry about the Kaaba. You think Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who has placed this Kaaba on the earth, will allow for on Monday? But there is a dispute concerning the dates. Some said he was born on the 9th, some said he was born on the 8th, some said he was born on the 12th, right? And the 12th is the most popular opinion, that he was born on the 12th of Rabi'ul Awwal. Is that clear? Yeah. So the year of the elephant was when they were waging a war against Makkah al-Mukarramah, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala destroyed them. And we all know Surah al-Fil, Allah said, أَلَمْ تَرَ كَيْفَ فَعَلَ رَبُّكَ بِأَصْحَابِ الْفِيلِ. Did you not see what Allah done to the people of the field, to the people of the elephant? And the scholars have said, why did Allah Azza wa Jal, why did that occur in the year that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was born? And why that protection at that particular time for Makkah al-Mukarramah? All in preparation for the birth of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Is that clear? The scholars have said that was in preparation for the blessed birth of the Prophet ﷺ. Then the Shaykh, he said, his mother did not experience any heaviness or cravings for certain foods whilst pregnant. It's known that when women are pregnant, their bodies feel heavy, their bodies change, they have a craving towards a particular food. But do you know the mother of the Prophet ﷺ, Sayyida Amina radiallahu anha, she didn't even know that she was pregnant until she saw a dream in which she saw Jibreel alayhi salam, who said to her, "Hal dariti annaki qad hamilt?" Do you know that you are pregnant? And she said, "No." And then Jibreel alayhi salam said to her, "Innaki qad hamilti bi sayyidil alameen." You are carrying and you are pregnant with the liege lord and the master of all of the world, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Then when she woke up, she said to herself that the dream that she had seen clarified for her why her menstruation had stopped. For when women are pregnant, the menstruation periods stop in those months that they are pregnant in. Her periods had stopped, but she didn't know why. And it was only that dream that clarified for her. Now, why was it that she didn't feel any heaviness throughout the 9 months that she carried the Prophet ﷺ? She didn't feel any heaviness at all. Why? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was sending the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as what? وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا رَحْمَةً لِلْعَالَمِينَ. We did not send you but as a mercy to the worlds. And the first person who should be the recipient of that mercy is his mother, radiyallahu anha. Right? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wasn't to make him a mercy for the world and a burden for his own mother. So hence she did not feel any heaviness. She did not feel any craving for any particular foods while she was pregnant with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. She felt absolutely normal at all times. This indicates the mercy of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam towards his mother. Is that clear? Whereas in all other situations, mothers feel a heaviness. Mothers, when they feel this heaviness, they are showing mercy towards their children in their wombs. Is that clear? But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was to make the mercy of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam even greater than the mercy of mothers. Why? Because on the Day of Judgment, when Allah said, يَوْمَ يَنْفِرُّ الْمَرْءُ مِنْ أَخِيهِ وَأُمِّهِ وَأَبِيهِ وَصَاحِبَتِهِ وَبَنِيهِ, on the Day of Judgment, when people run away from each other, brothers will run away from each other, parents, mothers and fathers will run away from their children, spouses will run away from each other, companions will run away from each other. Who will be the one who will stand solely and say to the believing people, "Ana laha, ana laha"? It is me today who will save you and give you shafa'ah and intercede for you before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Not our mothers on that day, but the one who was granted mercy greater than our mothers, and that's the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Is that clear? Naam. And then the Shaykh, he said that when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was born, Sayyida Amina radiyallahu anha said that when the time of delivery came close, she said, "At the time when I delivered the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, kharaja minni nurun faraaytu bihi qusur ash-sham." She said, "A light exited from my body with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's birth. A light exited from my body by which I was able to see the palaces of ash-sham." And how far were the palaces of Sham? She was in Makkatul Mukarramah, and the palaces of Sham are in Syria, two countries away, right? The light of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was so extraordinary, and it was so piercing and so powerful and so far spreading that his mother was given vision from Makkah of the palaces in Syria. And the mother of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam also informs us that when he was born sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he was born circumcised. He was born pure and circumcised. And he was born without an umbilical cord. Right? When every child is born, the nurses take that child. What do? They cut the umbilical cord and they tie a knot. Isn't that right? That umbilical cord connects a child onto the mother, and that's the channel through which the child feeds off the mother. Is that clear? But the Prophet ﷺ didn't have an umbilical cord to indicate what? That this is not a child who will become burdensome for his mother, will not become heavy upon his mother, will not bring difficulties for his mother to such an extent that even in his mother's womb, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was nurturing him and giving him nourishment through his mercy subhanahu wa ta'ala, such that he didn't have to feed off his mother. And we see this later on in the blessed life of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, where he would fast for days on end. When we fast, we open our fast at what time? Maghrib, isn't that right? The Prophet would fast and he would not open his fast at Maghrib, and he would join on the next day. And then he would join on the next day. This is known as sawmul wisal, continuous fasting without opening the fast. Some of the companions, they began to practice this. And when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam heard about this, he summoned them. He said, "What are you guys doing?" They said, "Messenger of Allah, we saw you fasting for days on end, so we thought we'd do the same." And the Prophet said to them, "Lastu ka hayatikum, I'm not like any one of you. My form, my body, the way I am, I'm not like you. Abitu 'inda rabbi yut'imuni wa yasqini. I sleep at night and my Lord gives me food and drink and nourishes me." No. And the scholars said that this part of the hadith, abitu, it can have two meanings. One of the meanings of abitu is that I sleep at night and my Lord gives me food and drink and he gives me nourishment. Another one of the meanings of the word abitu is that I live through my life and my Lord constantly and continuously gives me nourishment through food and drink. Whether that's food and drink that was physically present and he ate with others, or a food and drink that was spiritual, that would not only nurture his spirit and his soul, but also would strengthen his blessed body, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Is that clear? Naam. And his finger was clenched except for his index finger, which was pointing upwards, like someone who is glorifying Allah by the index finger pointing upwards, tasbih. When the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was born, he had his shahada finger like this, pointing towards the heavens, right? Indicating what? The oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And soon as he was born, he was not born like any other child. His mother said when he was born absolutely pure, absolutely clean. And the fragrance that came from his blessed body was not a fragrance that anybody had ever smelt before. Wasn't a fragrance that, and he was oiled with the oils of paradise. When normal children are born, they are taken immediately by the nurses, washed and cleaned, and then passed by back to their mothers. But when the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa baraka wa sallam arrived to this world, he arrived in an absolute pure and clean state. Is that clear? And the first thing that he did was what? He made sajda. Nah. The great Imam Muhammad ibn Muhammad Abu Shahba radiallahu anhu mentions in his work on Sirah that the first thing that he did was that he went into sajda and he glorified his Lord subhanahu wa ta'ala. And some of the scholars mentioned that his sajda was such that one of his hands was upon the earth with his blessed head upon the earth and his hand pointing towards the sky to indicate that I am prostrating to the Lord of the heavens and the earth, and my reliance is only upon Him, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Naam. There is a dispute amongst the scholars. Some said that it was his grandfather who circumcised him on the seventh day. Right. Some said that he was born circumcised, and others said that it was his grandfather who circumcised him on the seventh day. And circumcision is one of the sunnahs of all of the prophets, right? Because it's a sign of purity and a sign of cleansiness that a person is circumcised. And nowadays there are many research papers that people have written upon those who are circumcised. They are saved of having cancer in that area of the body. Is that clear? So circumcision is the sunnah of the Anbiya. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in one hadith, he mentioned that there are 10 sunnahs of the prophets, and one of them is al-khitan, which is circumcision. Is that clear? Monday is a blessed day, since it has been related from Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal radiyallahu anhu, that he said that Ibn Abbas radiyallahu anhuma said the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was born on Monday, and through the blessings of his birth, Allah chose Monday, and whatever Allah chose for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that can only ever be the best choice. Isn't that right? What Allah chooses for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, it can only ever be the best choice, and the choice that has the greatest khair, the greatest goodness, and the greatest blessings ever in it. Is that clear? Now, so Allah chose for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam Monday for his birth, commissioned with prophethood on Monday. We know the hadith of Sahih Muslim, when a man came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and he said, "Messenger of Allah, why is it that you single out Monday to fast?" What did the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam say? He said, "ذَاكَ يَوْمٌ وُلِدْتُ فِيهِ وَفِيهِ أُنزِلَ عَلَيَّ." That's a day that I was born, and that's the day I was given revelation, for two reasons. Is that clear? And this shows the importance of the birth of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. There are some people who say, take the message from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, why do you need to speak about his blessed birth? That was a life that he lived before he announced his prophecy. Indeed, that was a life that he lived before he announced prophecy. But that life of his 40 years that he lived before announcing prophecy, that was the evidence and basis of his announcement. When the Prophet ﷺ stood upon the mountain of Mecca and he summoned the people of Mecca and he called them together, what did he say to them? He said to them, "What do you guys say about me? What do you know about me?" And they said, "مَا جَرَّبْنَا عَلَيْكَ كَذِبًا." We've never experienced you lie. أنت الصادق الأمين. You're the most truthful and trustworthy man in Mecca. We leave our valuables with you. We entrust you with our valuables. The Prophet ﷺ said to them, if that's what you know of me for the past 40 years of my life, that I am truthful and I am honest, then know that Allah has commissioned me with a mission, and Allah has given me revelation, and Allah has sent me to you as a prophet and messenger. So how can you say that those 40 years of his life that he lived before announcing prophecy had no significance, when they were the basis, those 40 years was the basis and evidence for the Prophet announcing his blessed life? And if you look at the life that he lived before announcing prophethood and the life that he lived after he announced prophethood, right? There's an imbalance. Where's the imbalance? The first part of his life was 40 years. The second part of his life was how much? 23 years. That's an imbalance. Isn't that right? What does this indicate? That the evidence has to be greater than the claim. He gave evidence of 40 years and then he came with his claim. And what was the claim? That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made me a prophet and messenger and commissioned me with revelation to propagate this religion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the birth of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is of great significance. If it was not of significance, then he could have said in that hadith, "I fast on Monday because Allah gave me revelation on Monday." But he said, "I fast on Monday because I was born on Monday to show gratitude to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for giving me life and giving me life on that particular day of Monday." Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the Quran, "وَذَكِّرْهُمْ بِأَيَّامِ اللَّهِ." Remind them of the days of Allah. The question is, all of the days belong to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What does this particularly speak about? Those days in which Allah Azza wa Jal gave you victory, Allah gave you success, Allah gave you some type of goodness. Remember those days with a special remembrance, because they were days that Allah Azza wa Jal showered His mercy upon you. So for example, people remember the days that they get married. Isn't that right? Why? Because they feel that was the day Allah gave them blessings. People remember the day that Allah gave them a child. Why? Because those are blessed days. People remember the days that they received their degree or had bought a house or had some type of success in this world. Isn't that right? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, every week he used to remember that day in which Allah Azza wa Jal gave him life, to show gratitude to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Is that clear? So if our births are of significance to us, that is His blessed birth not of significance to all of Allah's creation? Indeed it is. Why? Because His birth did not signify blessings for one family, one tribe, one people, one locality, but rather His birth signified mercy for the heavens and the earth and for all of Allah's creation. Everybody. Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma, he said, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam was born on Monday, commissioned with prophethood on Monday, passed away on Monday. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam left away on Monday, left this world on Monday. Now, some people, what do they say? Is the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam passed away on Monday. How can you speak about his blessed birth when that was the same day of sorrow, of the Prophet passing away from this world? What do we say? What do we say? We say to them that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Hayati khayrul lakum wa mamati khayrul lakum." My life is good for you and my death is good for you. His life and his death was not like our life and our death. His born and his departure was not like, his birth and his departure was not like our birth and our departure. When he arrived to this world, he arrived with blessings and mercy for Allah's creation. When he departed from this world, he departed leaving behind and sending on to us blessings from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Is that clear? Now, so we celebrate Monday because it's the day that he sallallahu alayhi wasallam arrived to this world. And we celebrate Monday because that was the day that he returned back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with us and with our concern and with thinking about us and with turning to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and interceding before him for us. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "In my blessed grave, your actions are presented to me. When I see good, I praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And when I see otherwise, I seek forgiveness for you from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala." Tell me, the day that he left this world, isn't that a blessed day for us? That he went to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and there he is seeking forgiveness for us? Is that clear? He said, Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Abbas said, arrived in Medina on Monday. The Prophet ﷺ entered into this blessed city of Madinatul Munawwara on Monday. And this was the city of illness. It was known as Yathrib, the city of illness. And then when the blessed foot of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam touched this land, it became Tayba and Taba. It became pure and cure. Became pure and cure. To such an extent that Imam al-Bukhari radiallahu anhu narrates in his Sahih that, you know, when ill people used to come to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he used to do this. He used to lick his blessed finger and then he used to place it on the ground of Medina. Now if you lick your finger and place it on the ground, what's going to happen? Some grains of sand will come onto your finger. He used to lick his blessed finger, place it onto the land of Medina, onto the ground of Medina. So hence some grains of sand used to come onto his finger. And then he used to raise it like this and he used to say, بِسْمِ رَبِّنَا بِرِيقَةِ بَعْضِنَا بِتُرْبَةِ أَرْضِنَا يُشْفَى مَرِيضُنَا. He used to say, with the name of our Lord, with the saliva of each other, with the blessings of our land, i.e. the land of Madinatul Munawwara, يُشْفَى مَرِيضُنَا, our ill ones are cured. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was returning from a journey with his companions, and it was extremely windy. Wind was coming from the direction of Medina, and the companions, they gathered their clothes and covered in on themselves. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam opened up his garments and he allowed for the wind to come towards his direction, and he said to his companions, open up, for this wind that's coming from Medina is a wind of shifa, is a wind of cure, is a wind of goodness. Medina only brings khair for people. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, إِنَّ الْإِيمَانَ لَيَزْرَأُ إِلَى الْمَدِينَةِ كَمَا تَزْرَأُ الْحَيَّةُ إِلَى جُحْرِهَا. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, Iman, faith, takes refuge in Medina the way a snake that's been attacked takes refuge in its hole in the earth. This is how Iman takes refuge in Madinatul Munawwara. Is that clear? And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, Al-Madinatu khayrun lahum law kanu ya'lamun. He said, Medina is better for them only if they knew. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, Man istata'a minkum an yamuta fil madinati falyamut. Any of you who is able to die in Medina, then he should try to die in Medina. People have ambitions for life. The Prophet gave us ambitions for death. People have ambitions for life. He gave us ambitions for death. What's your ambition for death? To die in Medina and to be buried in his blessed feet. Sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa baraka wa sallam. Naam. And raise the black stone on Monday. We know the story that the black stone, when Quraysh rebuilt the Kaaba al-Musharrafa, and they disputed as to who's going to place the black stone back into its place, and they were about to wage war against each other, and some intelligent person said, calm down, relax. The next person who walks into the masjid, let him decide for you. So they all sat and waited and looked towards who's going to come next into the masjid. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That wasn't no coincidence. It didn't just happen. Oh, I met him, I just met him. Coincidentally, no. This is all qadar. This is all decree of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. To honor the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Before he announced prophethood, when they saw him come into the masjid, they were all so overwhelmed and pleased, and they said, this is the most honest and truthful man that we all agree upon. Whatever he says, we will go with. And then he decided that the black stone is placed upon a cloth and everybody raises it, and then he places it back in its place, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That also occurred on Monday. Is that clear? No. On the night of his blessed birth, astonishing things happened. Was the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam born in the daytime or was he born at night? In Arabic, they say wulida laylat al-ithnain. In Arabic, they say wulida laylat al-ithnain, that he was born in the night of Monday, right? And when is the night of Monday? We know that the night night comes before the day. The night comes before the day. So Monday night is not Monday evening the way we know. Monday night is from Sunday Maghrib onwards. Is that clear? So from Maghrib of Sunday till Fajr of Monday, that's the night. From Fajr of Monday till Maghrib of Monday, that's the day. Is that clear? In Arabic, they say the Prophet ﷺ was born Laylat al-Ithnain, the night of Monday, which means what? For us, that means Sunday evening. Isn't that right? But was he born at night? When was he actually born? He was born at the time of Al-Fajr al-Sadiq. at the time of true dawn. Now, if you ask the astronomers, they'll tell you that there's two types of dawns, right? At night, when it's pitch black, the sky is pitch black, sometimes, not all the time, there is a vertical light that appears in the sky. And this doesn't happen all the time. Some people think it happens all the time. It only occurs sometimes, that there's a vertical light that appears in the sky. This is known as al-fajrul kathib. This is known as the lying, the false dawn. Why is it known as the false dawn? Because as it appears in the sky vertically, soon after it disappears and it goes dark again. Is that clear? Then after, we have the true dawn, which is known as al-fajrul sadiq, the true dawn. That doesn't appear vertically in the sky, that appears horizontally across the horizon from east to west. And that appears, when it appears immediately and dawn breaks. Is that clear? It appears immediately and dawn breaks. And then its light gradually spreads across the horizon from east to west, and then it fills the entire sky. Why was the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam born at the time of al-fajr al-sadiq? Number one, al-fajr al-kathib, that appears in the sky vertically, right, shows arrogance, right? Somebody who stands up immediately, this is a sign of arrogance, number one. Number two, that light appears and then it disappears. This is why it's known as the false dawn. Allah Azza wa Jal decided for the birth of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to be at the time of al-fajrul as-sadiq, true dawn, to indicate that he is the Prophet who by his blessed birth will remove the darknesses of misguidance with the light of guidance. Through his blessed birth, the sky which was pitch black with misguidance, with deviance, with not knowing God, will now have a light that appears that will clarify to minds and hearts and eyes and ears the reality of this world and connect man back onto Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Is that clear? And then the light of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, it spread gradually. Isn't that right? It spread gradually, 40 years. And then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's light had reached the middle of the sky, and it was absolutely clear, and that's when Allah made him announce it. Do you know when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was married to Sayyida Khadija radiallahu anha? It was long before he announced that he was a prophet. He was only around 25 years of age, and she used to treat him so well. So one day the Prophet said to her, "Khadija, why do you treat me so well? Huh? The way you treat me is not normal." And Sayyida Khadija said, "I once heard that we are living in the time of the last and final prophet. And the traits and the qualities that I've seen in you, I think it must be you." And the Prophet ﷺ didn't say to her, "Indeed it's me." He said, "If it's me, then you will have your reward. And if it's not, then Allah will give you your reward." So even Sayyida Khadija radiallahu anha noticed sallallahu alayhi wasallam from amongst them, such as many of the idols falling flat on their faces and from their places. When he sallallahu alayhi wasallam was born, people didn't know why this happened, but idols that were erected around the Kaaba al-Musharrafa and people used to worship them, they dropped down, they fell upon their faces to announce what? That the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who is coming to teach people la ilaha illallah and the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, has now arrived. Light emerged with him as he was born, such that the palaces of Sham were illuminated. There was a fire that the people of Persia used to worship. And this fire was flaming for 1,000 years and was never extinguished. At the time when the Prophet ﷺ was born, it immediately extinguished. A fire that was flamed and that was fueled and that was burning for 1,000 years, extinguished at the time of his blessed birth, to indicate what? That no matter how strong the force is, no matter how strong the force is, no matter how powerful the evil is, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, his presence, his existence, his birth, his blessings can defeat all of that. Can defeat all of that. And that's important for all of us, that if we bring him sallallahu alaihi wasallam into our lives, then the forces of evil can be defeated only through him sallallahu alaihi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa barak wa sallam. Okay, next the Shaykh speaks about nursemaids and wet nurses. Nursemaids and wet nurses of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wa sallam. Allahumma salli wa sallim wa barik alihi wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa barik wa sallam. The Shaykh rahimahullah ta'ala, he said, the first woman to suckle him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was his mother, Lady Amina al-Zuhriya radiyallahu anha. The first woman that he took sallallahu alayhi wa sallam milk from was his own mother, Sayyida Amina radiyallahu anha. Is that clear? You might think, why is this being mentioned? This is very important in the time that we live in. Why? Yesterday we were in a lesson, and it was mentioned in that lesson that it is important that we read about the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the times that we live in. It's always been important, but it seems to be even more important now, and as time is progressing and gradually moving towards the end of time. Why? It's important that we read about him and know about his perfect life, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, because he was the most perfect embodiment of humane nature. Before we become good Muslims and before we know how to live as Muslims, we need to restart learning how to live as human beings. Because human nature has started to change in us. There was a time when mothers were known to be the embodiment of greatest mercy in every civilization, every culture, every people, every area of the earth. But this is no longer the situation. It's not generic like that across the world. How do we know this? Because now we have women who don't want to suckle their young ones, who deprive their young ones of their right of being suckled by their mothers, of being given milk by their own mothers. Is that clear? And you'll see when you go into the hospitals, you'll see they have these charts where they show the countries in which babies are not suckled by their mothers. They are not given milk by their mothers. And this later on in life, it causes physical and mental illnesses in children. Why? Because even from that age, a child knows his mother. You know, a newly born child, every mother knows this, every nurse knows this. A newly born child knows exactly who the mother is in that room from the nurses. Isn't that right? Right? And when that mother is given the child is attached and clings on to the mother immediately. Which means what? That this child has feelings towards the mother and has senses towards the mother. But when mothers start to deprive their children at that age of their milk, then what happens? Those children, when they grow up, they can have psychological scars. They can have mental illnesses. They can feel deprived of mercy. And at what stage? At the stage of birth. Is that clear? So the first woman to give milk to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was his own mother, Sayyida Amina radiyallahu anha. And when mothers give this affection and love and this milk to their young ones, give it to their young ones, then those children grow up to be healthy in their bodies, as the doctors have said, but also healthy in their minds and healthy in their hearts and in their affection and love. Is that clear? No. And the purity and the goodness of that mother is passed into the children through that milk. One of the great imams of this ummah, Sayyidina Al-Hasan Al-Basri radiyallahu anhu, he was described that, you know, when he spoke, أَشْبَهُ النَّاسِ بِكَلَامِ الْأَنْبِيَاءِ. When he spoke, his speech was the most resemblant of the speech of the prophets. Do you know why? Because he was given milk by one of the wives of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And they say the blessings of that milk was such that it made his tongue so eloquent. Is that clear? Followed by Suwaybah al-Aslamiyya for a number of days. Who was Suwaybah? She was Abu Lahab's slave, whom he set free when she brought him the good news that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was born. Suwaybah al-Aslamiyya was the slave girl of Abu Lahab, who was the uncle of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and later on he became the Prophet's enemy also. When the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was born, Suwaybah came to Abu Lahab and said, "Your brother Abdullah, who had passed away, has had a child." He was so ecstatic and so happy to know and hear that my brother will have a sign left after him. Because remember the dramatic death of the father of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that he died far away from home in Madinatul Munawwara, and his relatives and his parents weren't able to see him before he passed away, and he was buried there. It broke everybody's heart, and amongst them was Abu Lahab. So when the slave girl said, "Your brother Abdullah has had a son," he raised his finger, his index finger, towards her and said, "You're free." He set her free. Is that clear? And she was honored that she gave milk to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam also. Abu Lahab, he was seen in a dream after he died, and he was asked, "Ma fa'ala Allahu bik?" What did Allah do with you? And he said, "I'm in punishment every day. Except on Monday, my punishment is lessened and I'm given water through this index finger." Why? He said, "Because I celebrated the birth of my nephew Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave me relief on that day of Monday." This is why Imam Shamsuddin Nasiruddin al-Dimashqi radiyallahu anhu says, "Iza kana hadha kafirun, ja'a zammuhu bitabbat yada abi lahabin." If this is a kafir who Allah has blamed in Suratul Lahab, and he said, "May both of the hands of Abu Lahab be destroyed," Allah blamed him and said, "May his both hands be destroyed," and it is confirmed that he died as a kafir and his punishment is confirmed. If this is a kafir whose punishment is lessened and he is given water through his index finger for pointing at a slave girl and freeing her upon the birth and celebrating the birth of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, "Fama zannuka," then what do you think about the one who all of his life followed and loved the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and died as a believing person? How much Allah will reward that person for remembering and celebrating the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Is that clear? Suwaybah was also considered by some scholars to be a companion, i.e. that later on she accepted Islam, and others disagreed. Suwaybah used to visit the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam after he married Khadija, and he sallallahu alaihi wasallam would honor her, as would Khadija. Why would he honor her sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Because anybody who done any good to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he never ever forgot that. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam never ever forgot anybody's good that they done towards him. He would always remember that, and he would always reward people upon that and remind them of the favors that they done towards him and the goods that they done towards him sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He sallallahu alaihi wasallam continued to send clothes and gifts to her after migrating to Medina until she passed away radiyallahu anha. Thereafter, Halima bint Abi Duwayb al-Sa'diyah suckled him with the milk from her pregnancy with her son Abdullah, the brother of Anisa and Ashima. She took him with her to her land beyond At-Ta'if amongst Banu Sa'd, and there he stayed with her amongst them for 4 years according to the correct opinion. By suckling him, she gained much good in terms of ample sustenance and prosperity. It was the trait of the Arabs that they would send out their young children into the deserts. Why would they do that? So that their children grow up strong in their physique. Because when you live in a tough environment, when you live in a rough, tough environment, you will grow up to be rough and tough. Is that clear? Whereas when you live in a very comfortable environment and then some type of toughness comes to you, you usually break like a biscuit body. Right? Most of us are biscuit bodies. Right? Somebody touches you, I broke my arm. Right? This is why they would send out their children so that they grow up with strong physique. This was one reason. Another reason was that language in the deserts and in the villages and amongst the Bedouins was still very strong and uncorrupt. It hadn't been mixed with foreign words, so this was another reason that they would send them out. The people of Banu Sa'd came to Makkah al-Mukarramah and they went around to the houses and every woman took a child. This was like a job, right? The families would pay them to take their children and look after them. Halima radiallahu anha knocked the door of the house of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and she said, "Do you have a child?" They said, "Yes, but he's an orphan." Or she said, "Oh, leave him then." Because they thought, people thought that if that child is an orphan, we're not going to get paid much. So it's not really worth it for us. She carried on and went around to the houses of Makkah, and there were no other children, they were all taken. She didn't want to go back home empty-handed because her friends would say, "Oh, you didn't get anything, right? You're not going to have much earnings." So reluctantly she went back and she knocked the door of the Prophet ﷺ's house again. She said, "I'll take that child." She said, "He was clothed in a green garment, and when the cloth was moved from in front of his blessed face, his shining eyes, when they looked towards me, it was as if I had never seen beauty like this beauty, fragrance like this fragrance that I saw in the blessed face of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam." She said, "When I carried this blessed child and placed him upon my camel, when I came to Makkah, my camel was the weakest and the slowest. It became the strongest and the fastest. And I preceded all of my friends and they said to me, 'Have you changed your camel?' I said, 'No, it's the same camel, but this child that we've bought, innahu nasamatun mubarakah, he is a blessed seed and a blessed child.'" And when she returned with him to Banu Sa'd, when the people of Banu Sa'd used to be ill, she used to wash the blessed feet of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam at this young, tender age, and they used to give that water to the ill, and they used to be cured through the blessings of that water that by which the blessed feet were washed sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave prosperity and gave wealth to the house of Halima Sa'diyah radiyallahu anha through the presence of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Ashima, who is Halima Sa'diyah's daughter, would together with her mother look after him. Halima returned him back to his mother out of fear for him because of the incident wherein his chest was split open. Shima used to play with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. right? And she used to say lines of poetry, and she used to say, Allahumma inna hadha akhi Muhammadan. Oh Allah, this is my little brother Muhammad. Oh Allah, this is my brother Muhammad. Allow me to see him grow up and to be a young man. Right? And in the tribe of Banu Sa'd, when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was around 4 years of age, the children of Banu Sa'd, or Sayyida Halima's other children, came running to her and said, Mother, our Qurayshi brother has been killed. Our Qurayshi brother has been killed. And Sayyida Halima came rushing out, and she saw the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and his color had changed, and he looked kind of shocked. And she took him and said, Child, are you okay? And the Prophet said, I'm fine. And she took him straight back to Makkatul Mukarramah, to his mother, because she feared for him. She didn't know what had happened. And what had happened was Jibreel and Mikail alayhim as-salam came, and they split open his blessed chest and took out his blessed heart and washed it with the water of Zamzam and replaced it into his chest, and then sewed up his chest and gave him open heart surgery, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Right now, so at that time, Sayyida Halima returned him back to his mother in Makkatul Mukarrama. After that, she did not see him after that except twice. Once after he married Khadija, when she came complaining to him of a drought, and so Lady Khadija gave her 20 sheep and other gifts. And the second time was on the day of Hunain, that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam met Shayma radiyallahu anha. Sorry, Halima Sa'diya radiyallahu anha, that he met her at these two occasions. Ayman Barak al-Habashiyya, so the first woman to give milk to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was his own mother, then Suwayba al-Aslamiyya, then Halima al-Sa'diyya, and now Ayman Barak al-Habashiyya also took him in her care. He had inherited her from his father. When he grew up, he freed her and gave her away in marriage to Zayd ibn al-Haritha radiyallahu anhu. Baraka al-Habashiyya, Ayman Baraka al-Habashiyya looked after the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and she was probably the only woman who was present at the birth of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and she was still alive at the death of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. She outlived him sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and she saw his entire life from birth to death. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he used to refer to her, he used to say, Ummi ba'da ummi. Ayman Barak al-Habashiyya is my mother after my mother. And she was African. And she used to cook African food for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And she used to say some African words which the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam memorized from her. And later on, when the people of Habasha came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the Prophet spoke to them with those words, and he said, I learned them from Ayman Barak al-Habashiyya radiyallahu anha. And he said that when the Africans cooked food for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the Prophet said, I ate this food in my young days when Ayman used to cook for me. Is that clear? Naam. So Ayman Barak al-Habashiyya was the same woman who traveled with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and his mother to Madinatul Munawwara, and on the way back, when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's mother fell ill in Abwa and she passed away and she was buried there, it was Ayman Barak al-Habashiyya radiyallahu anha who brought the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam back to Makkatul Mukarramah and took care of him and passed him to his grandfather, and then he stayed in the custodianship of his grandfather sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Subhana rabbika rabbil izzati amma yasifun wa salamun ala al-mursaleen walhamdulillahi rabbil alameen.